them.
Thank you very much.
It was blue.
I was going for the color.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's special called city council meeting. This Tuesday, January 30th, 2024, and according to our brand new clock, digital clock at the back, it is 6:06 p.m. Miss Darla, Miss Sherritt. City Clerk Treasurer, would you call the roll, please?
Ms. Barry. Nancy Brown.
Here.
Ralph Meeker.
Here.
Tim Terry's absent. Roger Rainwater.
Here.
Danny McDaniel.
Here.
And Rod Powell.
Here.
There's a quorum.
Thank you. We have two items on the agenda this evening. One is a resolution to adopt the 2024 City of Greenwood budget, and two is finance resolution amending resolution number 123-03, adopting official salary range schedule to adjust for the COLA. So, with that, Mr. Tom, you want to get us started? This pizza is for everybody here, so visitors and everybody alike, please enjoy at any time.
3% off what we actually budgeted for as far as revenue was concerned. So that's how the budget, I would hope, every year looked like, because that's what a balanced budget looks like when your revenues and expenses match. And you're not having to dip into your fund balance, which is what we've been doing for the last 6 years. The next thing is the actual revenue to actual expense. And I think you can readily see what the issue is. It's in 2023, right here. Because our actual expense exceeded our revenue stream, which means we are now actually dipping into our fund balances in order to be able to achieve that same level. Interestingly enough, we had, and you'll see these numbers in a little bit, the capital expense was much higher than the actual spend was much higher than it's been in all previous years. Almost 40% of what was budgeted for capital was actually spent citywide. That's the highest since I've been here. Usually it's around the low 20s, or 20%. Even water sewer, which is a large percentage of our capital spend, spent the highest amount that they've spent in any of the previous year, 6 years. As far as the next thing I want to talk about, there are some items that were tabled in some of the budget study sessions that you guys need to be dealing with today. These are, there's, I think, 14 little items that we want to go over and discuss. The first item, because at the last budget study session, was the increases for elected officials. That was something that the two that were here, Ralph and Roger, decided that they didn't want to go ahead and make that decision. They didn't feel comfortable without sharing the information with the entire body. So that's the first thing that you need to do. What we did, though, is put in a placeholder at the recommendation of the council that were here. 3%, 1.3%, that's because that caps Charlotte at the max. And then the city attorney, 3%. Those are just placeholders. And I will turn it over to you for your discussions on what you feel needs to be done for the budget.
Thank you, Tom. So, like he said, I think the first thing first is just as he has it numbered. So anybody have thoughts and/or comments or? Yeah. With number one? Or suggestions? Silence is a no, I guess? Yes? Or do you?
Well, when you're talking about, I guess I was kind of looking here, you know, in, on the, in the general, you know, it was like a 2.9 instead of a 3.2.
2.9 is the COLA. That's what you all decided on. You decided to go with the state COLA, cost of living for the state of Arkansas, which is not the national. National COLA was 3.2. That moves the max, but if, what you awarded to the whole city, citywide, was 2.9, which is the state's.
Okay.
So that's what that is. But that would have been awarded regardless.
Right.
So what we were looking at, we didn't have anything in there for the merit incentive adjustment. And at the budget study session for general, Ralph and Roger decided that they wanted to at least put a placeholder in there and let you guys discuss it with the majority of the body to decide on what you think would be appropriate.
Well, again, with everything rolled up, you know, how does the, all the merits look?
We can get to that. That will be a, I have a slide in here on the salaries. I haven't gotten to it yet, but I've. If you go to your page seven in your packet, page seven, see there, in that hard copy right there on your shelf,
This is right here, Bob.
The hard copy right there.
Yeah.
You can look at it right there, or you can look at it on your tablet, page 7. Hard copies, there's only 2 hard copies, and all the other ones on there.
What's this then?
That's the ordinances.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
So this is mine here.
It's shareable.
Sure.
You didn't want to fill a tree. Wonder if there's going to be changes to it. So this is your payroll right there.
It's a renewable resource. I'm just saying.
What'd you say?
It's a renewable resource. Support forestry and issues.
There you go.
Nice.
You notice that the year over year right now, the payroll went from $4 million to $4,335,000. That's with the COLA. COLA was 2.9%, so they took it to 3.63%, which was the year over year percentage increase all in the city. Remember, this is just salaries, not band related. It doesn't include any of the taxes, anything that goes with those salaries. It doesn't include the retirement. It just is the wages. And if you look down below the 2.9%, that means that the average increase was 5.73 outside of the rate of cost of living overall for the city. You can also see under there on that, and we'll go into what those rest of the statistics mean when I get to that slide, but the percentage growth since 2018 is 48.57% since 2018. An average year over year is 6.9.
Which is pretty close to 7%.
Right, but you're not weighing this against the entire payroll as much as you're looking at those individuals. They're not that significant dollar-wise to the entire payroll.
I guess I'm not understanding when you say that, when it's not as significant to the entire payroll.
$4 million, you're looking at $1,000 or $2,000 for the mayor, $1,000 for the city attorney. That's not significant to the payroll. That's already in this budget.
Oh.
So if you wanted to give them anything more than that, it's immaterial to the bottom line of that payroll. You're not going to, it's not going to save the city a ton of money by not giving them that or giving them more. That's what I'm saying. Those 3 payrolls are not significant to that $4 million.
Hey, Tom, there's 2 lines there. One is total budgeted revenue and then payroll as a percentage.
I'll get to those at the end and tell you what that means.
Okay. I was just wondering what the difference between those 2 lines were.
One is operational and one is total to the city. The operational revenues and the operational expenses are different than the total expenses, primarily because the total expenses of the city include capital. Capital doesn't generate, usually it's outsourced capital too. They're buying an asset that's tangible, or it's job sourcing out some construction project that's not done internally. The monies that are used to pay those projects are not labor money. They're not monies that go to paying your salaries. So I exclude that out to show you the impact of the revenue stream that generates for your payroll versus the revenue streams that generate without consideration of your payroll.
And that should typically be less than 30.
Okay, might as well just talk about this stream.
Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, there you go. Go ahead.
Revenue that's up here, $14,902,000, that's the total for the city, all in total revenue, including your city sales and use tax, which is used for mostly your capital projects and your capital expenditures. percent. You want to keep your payroll roughly 30% or about a third of your revenue and or expense side. But in this case, the city is normally construed to be a high labor industry, if you will. Or
service.
Company. We're very labor intense. And so you can go as high, they say, as 40% when it comes to that. But another way to look at it is that for every dollar that you bring in, 30% of that dollar, or 30 cents on the dollar, goes to paying your payroll for the city. All right? So that's about normal for the industry, for any company. They all try to keep your payrolls within a third. As far as your budgeted expense is concerned up here, this percentage of budgeted expense, that's the total expense right now, and you see the impact what capital does to that percentage. Capital is huge in this budget right now, and it's huge primarily due to the capital that's being budgeted for water sewer. Water sewer has an enormous capital outlay right now, about $9 million, between $8 and $9 million right now in that number. So that's what skews these numbers to down 0.17%. So when you remove the capital numbers and you just look at the operating revenues and the operating, what it takes to run a department, which is your material supplies, your labor, retirement pay, anything that's in operating, not actually dedicated towards capital, you're looking down here as our revenues, 40.81%, and an operating payroll percentage to expense of 39.17. So you're still in that ballpark that we were in the previous years. It's just 4.3 million in a total payroll up at the very top there. That's a large number, and the increase went from 2.7 million since 2018 up to that number. And there's a large percentage when you go through your payroll, just to be totally honest with you, that a large percentage of our number of employees are at or near cap. So you're suggesting no movement for years to come, which is other than COLA, if you wanted to do the COLA, because that does move the salary range. Or you're going to have to be looking at doing some kind of a salary range analysis again to see if you're losing employees, where are you losing them to? Are we competing against municipalities, or are we competing against other industries? And there's strong suggestion that other industries play a very big factor. So that's what that means. That's just your statistical look. I mentioned last year, and I said it again this year, that cities which are labor intensive, or any industry that's labor intensive, you can go, CEOs usually go as high as 40%. And we're hovering right at that.
Tom, can you go back to the first slide, Morning?
How to do this?
Please.
The very first slide?
Yep. No, the very, the salary. The one you had up there. Well, that's what we're trying to get them to.
The very first slide?
Yes, the very first slide.
The very first slide is the one I just.
There you go.
The number one.
One through six.
One through six.
The list of the things that, the four that were not here.
Oh. That's not the very first slide.
Well.
Oh, what you're saying.
That's, sorry.
Thank you.
The reason I ask is this was presented to the gentleman for approval or disapproval. I feel like we're going to go backwards and forwards 15 times if we don't just keep going the way we are. And I'm not saying anybody can ask any question at any time. That's what this is for. And certainly once you approve something, in my opinion, if you're okay with something and we move on, before you vote, you can come back and change something. This is the way we've always done it. So what I think what we need is it was explained for the four that weren't here, actually three, I guess, because we're still missing one. The two that were here passed these things on to you
for your consideration, because you weren't here, so we need to get the three that weren't here to give a yea or nay to move on, as these are presented.
What was number six?
Well, we ain't got there yet.
One.
Oh, one.
This is a list that I have to present to you, but we're gonna go one.
I vote to pass on number one.
Pass?
Pass.
Why are you passing?
Because
We're trying to get to a budget where we can vote tonight, Mr. Brown. Why would you pass?
Because I think the COLA is enough.
For the three elected officials?
Yes.
Interesting. Anybody else have an opinion? You're fine with it as it is? Rod?
I have no opinion.
This is crazy, people.
Y'all are the city council. How can you not have an opinion or pass on something? And I know I'm putting myself in a corner here, obviously. But my question is, why are we passing and why do we not have an opinion? You are the council.
I'm okay with it. I just don't really have a strong opinion either way.
So you're okay with it? You're okay with it?
I said I was okay with it.
No, you said I don't have an opinion.
I said I'm okay with it. I don't have a strong opinion either.
Okay, I don't, anyway. Mr. Rainwater?
Well, me and Ralph is...
I know, and so you are, AC still...
Basically, these three.
Can I ask you why you're not okay with it?
I just think that we're in a tough budget year. I mean, some of the...
So the first thing you want to do is not give merit raises in a tight budget year. The first thing you want to do. Is it because of the mayor?
No, I'm just saying that, that's why, I was looking at the, I've said COLA, I think it's sufficient.
For everybody in the city?
Yeah.
Everybody, or just those three?
I'd have to look at the, really, again, how everything else, falls in there and stuff. I haven't seen, again, how the whole budget has rolled up.
You will...
I mean, that's really what...
Is this your first budget?
You look at how the whole budget rolls up and see how everything is...
So you're not gonna say yea or no on anything until we get to the end?
When it comes to...
I'm gonna ask you a personal question. Is it because the mayor has a suggested merit raise?
No, I said I'd really like to, wait for all merit raises. I'm fine with the COLA.
But you're not gonna answer my question.
How about we do this? How about we do this last, and I show you it rolled up, and then you can come back?
Here's what I'm gonna suggest from now on. I've got 3 years left. If the council can't make it to the budget study sessions, we need to be moving on with the people that are here. And there were some good excuses to not be here at the last one, but there were some sad ones. That's what I'm gonna say. So, present the budget. By the way, my job is...
Say something like that, then you say we just reschedule it then.
What?
Because if you didn't have a quorum, we just reschedule it then.
It's a budget study session. It's not a meeting. We schedule those...
Okay, that's fine. You're gonna go ahead and do it.
We did do it.
Okay.
But you come back in afterwards and want to change it or not do it because you weren't here to hear it.
The two councilmen that were here said that they want to present these things at this meeting.
Right. I'm going to pass, and I don't care from two of the four, three that weren't here, four. I'm just saying it's ridiculous. That's what I'm saying.
The only reason we put up some figures there for you to look at to see what your opinion was.
This is every year, and it just gets worse every year.
Every year, I always say that I'd like to see how the whole budget is before we consider merit raises.
We're not asking you. I started my speech by saying anything you're okay to pass on, you can come back before you vote and change it. That's exactly what I said. Not pass on it, or I don't care.
The only question I would have about any of it, Mayor,
yes, sir,
on the city attorney's side,
yes, sir,
which he's not here, so I don't think we can have the discussion.
I think you have to have the discussion.
I'm fine if we want to, there was a discussion with him about bringing a job, redoing his job description.
Or telling us what he wanted to charge.
Right.
Yeah, that kind of all got tabled or whatever.
I think this is
I know there's some people have heartburn over the bill that comes. I mean, item two, I guess 3,000 was last year.
About three.
That's what he billed us, is the 3,000, I guess.
Total, yeah.
A little under that.
I mean, I almost want to say bump his base salary 3,000 and don't send us any more bills. Or, I mean, as Tom's point, I mean, it's not a material, it's not this huge number. If that's 30,000, that's obviously a huge problem, but,
right.
I mean, that's just been something that's kind of unresolved, I guess, is.
I agree, and I would say this is the night to do that. Whatever you're going to do, you need to make it.
On this, I'm a little different and just okay with it. I got an opinion.
Okay.
That $3,000 reflects actual work being done. And if we add it to his salary, that salary doesn't actually mean work has been done. That $3,000 was paid for work that was done, and that work was good.
However,
I'd prefer not to increase his salary and just continue to pay for things like that.
I think the thing that we need to resolve, which we can't resolve sitting right here now, is this job description, I'll call it, I guess that's what it is, you know, was you ran for a position that said, here's this job description, the expectations of what we're going to do. And so Travis at one point said, well, I'm going to go rewrite that. You know, that was, and we never did that. That never got rewritten or whatever.
Right.
So I think we just need to clearly understand, here, what do we expect you to do? And obviously there's things, if we have some huge lawsuit or whatever that takes a lot of his time, I would understand him billing us for that. If he comes here for a meeting with you, I mean, I think previous attorneys have done that, and we didn't get a bill for it. I think that's expected base activity, if you will. But
I couldn't agree more.
It goes back, though, to this. We're going to have to sit down with Travis and go through this agreement and say, all right.
I'll say this. I think Travis is a good attorney. I think he's doing us a good job. I have no issues with him at all. I know there are some issues in the crowd of returning calls. These are from department heads. I know that for a fact. He responds to me very well. I totally agree that the guidelines have not been set. He has not provided, and I've told him myself, you need to get those guidelines or those suggestions to the council for their approval or disapproval. It's hard for you gentlemen, to make a decision based on what you don't know.
And we have those guidelines, but they were really old.
Well,
right?
I'm talking about, he has a job description. I'm talking about what he feels like he can charge us for outside of his salary. And to me, if I was voting on this budget, which as you know I do not, is until you see that, I think you should be on hold with that.
That I agree with.
I think you just wait and get that from him, and then you make a decision. You can change.
I see that his expenses, whatever, is that 1668? I see here it says fees, legal, city attorney. It says it's 1668 for 2023.
Yeah, the three includes what we've done in 24 and that, right, Tom? Up until today?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean,
but you can't, in my opinion, humbly, you can't really base that, and I think it's a great point that whoever said it, I think you said it, the things that he's done were needed, and they may not be needed next year. I mean, you're not going to, so adding it to his salary is a little. I don't disagree that he ought to get paid, necessarily that he ought to get paid for extra things, but the extra things aren't identified.
Some of those things were directly incurred costs that the city was reimbursing for, basically.
Yeah. So until that identification is made by him and you guys agree to it.
So Charlotte makes a good point. You wouldn't want to add that to his salary,
right,
if it's reimbursable cost from
right.
filing fees and all this.
Yeah, because he may not.
Because he's going to turn around and.
Yeah.
Do that again.
Well, adding it to there, I mean, if you think about it, you know, with our ordinance we have for elected officials, you come in at the minimum, right, on the pay scale, you know, Hamby was here, Hamby was maxed, and then the new guy comes in at the bottom.
Right.
That's all understood. I mean, I don't think Travis had a problem with it and all that.
Right.
You know, we need to evaluate what we're getting for the money and determine if his salary needs to increase or not. I don't know enough about it to make that call.
That's exactly my point. Yep.
It's the $1,000 is an insignificant number, but I think we ought to put the city attorney piece on hold and revisit that with Travis.
Okay, that's what
let's get a job description or whatever.
Job description, we do need that definition of his scope of work.
Right.
And the things that are outside of his scope of work.
Sure.
And if he's willing to do those things outside of the scope of work, I'm fine with him billing us instead of hiring somebody else.
Okay. So let me do this. Number one, Mayor, 3%, 2108.56. The majority here is good to let that keep going until for now. Am I right?
Yes.
4-1. City Clerk Treasurer, 1.3%, 892.59. It's a cap. That's the reason it's 1.3. Is everybody okay with that moving forward for now?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. City Attorney, you're gonna hold that. Or is that correct? You want to wait until further information?
In my opinion, to hold it. But
well, I need your.
I'd say go ahead and put it in the budget.
I agree.
Place it.
In the budget.
Place it.
For doing everything else, then go ahead and place it.
Well, but one thing.
That's an odd reason, but okay.
Think about this for just a second. You can raise an elected official's salary, you cannot reduce it during their term.
That's correct.
If you change the number, you change the number. Which I'm fine with. I don't care if you change the number, but don't come back next month and say, I'm taking the $1,000 away.
That is right. That is correct.
I'm fine with moving forward with what's up there.
Just like it is?
Like it is.
I also want to add, though, we need a policy or something because the city lost almost $1,000 for scheduling his lodging and fees for AML, and it was a no-show. So we lost that money. That money, he did not show up. Others have done that before, and the city just loses money. And I think we need a policy. I just wanted you to be aware that did happen.
I would agree going further. We didn't even, and that's not the first time it's happened. You're right. Yeah. So let me start over. Number three, City Attorney, Mr. Brown, leave it.
Leave it.
Leave it?
Leave it.
Leave it.
All right.
With the city attorney fees, we also put money for our budget to cover professional expenses like that, too. So we're kind of covering those fees if we use that.
So that $3,000 is actually split among several departments? No?
That's general.
That's the general.
Okay.
Okay, we're on number two. So now we're on number two, legal city attorney fees, $3,000.
So that's a budgeted amount.
That's the amount in general.
For general.
In the general fund, budgeted, yes.
And actual was about $2,000 in 23.
In general, it was $1,600 last year.
Yeah. So, Tom, let me ask you, why did we break it out into his budget?
Because if he goes and does planning work for planning department or parks work for parks or does something for street, he builds those departments.
Mm-hmm. If I actually decide for an annexation or something like that he could, don't know yet, but he could send me a bill for it, and so I would have to pay it out of my budget.
Or if I need easements for a trailer.
Yeah.
So what are we paying out of general then for?
What we're going to get charged for, because if I call him and ask him a question, a legal question, is he wanting to send me a bill for that, like, my attorney? We don't know. But like Daniel says, the job description is not there, and he ran for the position on the job description, so if he changes the job description, it should take effect at the next election, I think. Just my opinion.
So the
we say that maybe with Hamby, sometimes the incentive wasn't there, and
I think our time busier than
We didn't get things.
With his private practice, it was hard to, you know, it's not the Greenwood Lake annexation, you know, that's 3.5 years to get that through.
A lot of things with Hamby, we didn't get in a timely manner because he had a private practice, and all of them are going to have a private practice because it's not a, we're not paying for a full-time position.
Travis has a private.
You run for the office with that private practice, you've already got it, so you know, if you're running for an office or you're applying for a job, and here's what's expected.
There's a point. Yeah.
It all goes, we need that document from him on
scope of work, and then we can adjust that.
It all goes back, and as soon as, and again, I appreciate him. I think he's going to be great. I think he's on his way to being great. I never have any issues ever, but this was talked about as soon as the election was over, and he made his announcement of how he wanted to be paid, and I'll include myself. We didn't do anything about it. And here we are.
And we've unanimously voted yes on every invoice.
Yeah, and we're all a year later. Has it been a year?
Yeah, it's been a year.
And here we are now at budget time discussing what we need to have from him. And it's fine, but we're all back on the same page that we got to get from him what he defines as.
Did y'all say he's a bit aloof when you're calling that?
I think it's fair. Raise your hand if you don't hear back timely.
Never called him.
So 1, 2, 3, 4.
I sent him a text just 2 days ago, and he was showed up at my office within.
Yeah. And again, I say that. Yeah, and me too. But
and
I
know. Me too. I didn't think here because I called his assistant.
I think they're calling Hamby's office, to be honest with you. That's a joke.
Was Hamby aloof?
No.
Oh, yes. So, okay.
The only way I could get through to Hamby was to go through Charlotte.
Right.
Yeah, he answered me right away.
So that's not a surprise.
Without having the current scope of work and needing to pass this budget, I would say we move forward with just leaving the $3,000 in there.
I agree with Ralph.
Okay. Very good.
And push the scope of work idea soon.
Okay. And I will do my part, but I need the council to help me with that. When he's here,
okay.
We need to be telling him that.
Yep.
He needs to know it. That good?
AC removed it last time from the agenda. Travis never brought it, and then finally AC removed it.
If we're not going to get anything from him, could we get someone from the administration to write this up?
Oh, I can. In my opinion, the job description, anything for the city. That's where he and I disagree. I mean, we don't get in a fight about it, but
Can we get a statement from the Municipal League on what they feel like is reasonable job duties for the?
Probably, but I will say that Danielle and I spoke to Mayor Black from Mansfield, who our city attorney is also the city attorney. He's not an elected official over there, and it's the same process with them. He bills them. And he didn't gripe about it. It's just something he stated. We asked.
That's right.
I said that. I said that.
But like,
okay.
I guess Sonny said for the easements around the lake, it took you like 3 years to get it.
Well, that was right.
I'm just saying, you know, things could be, you say, oh, yeah, that's in my description, but then it doesn't say anything how, in a timely manner, he has to produce something. You know, because he said if he didn't feel like he's, you know,
putting the time in,
doesn't feel like he's going to be adequately compensated for the time he's putting into all this, you know, is time consuming, and he's going to put the ones that, you know, pay the most up front, you know. And so I think you have to weigh that. I mean, do we want to have things to be held up and held up and held up?
Absolutely not. I just think we can go nowhere until he provides us
his job description,
a list of things that aren't that he feels the scope of work. That if it's an annexation issue, which we were charged for, I'm just giving some examples, right? I believe. No. Yes. An annexation discussion and work. we were charged for?
Yes.
To me? Bet City. I don't. So there's some stuff to find out and to get from him. And again, I'm publicly, I think he's good. I think he's good at his job. I've seen him work and I appreciated him, but this is an issue we need to get taken care of for everybody.
I'm with Ralph. We can beat this dead horse later.
Yep.
Let's move on for the sake of the budget.
Yep.
This is what I've been trying to do.
So instead of doing this, so that you guys can see the picture as to where we are and then we come back to these, is that how you would want to proceed? Because some of these items are large ticket items and you're going to probably have the same concern, and that is you don't know what the roll-up is, so why don't I just go through the roll-up first and then we come back? Right?
Yes.
Sounds good.
Go.
Yes, please.
Thanks, because there was 14 items on there. So I wanted first to give you the economic outlook. I'm very interested in the economic forecasts that are out there. Each week I get them from various sources, and I look through where the numbers are going, specifically to credit, borrowing, interest rates. This past Friday, in Rogers, Arkansas, the local and state economists met. And this is their report that came out on Monday. One of the things I wanted to point out was after a better-than-expected economy in 23, a 24 economy should see reduced consumer spending, lower wage growth, and a slightly higher unemployment rate, according to the economists. State-leading economists expect the state to add between 10,000 and 10,005 jobs in 24. Roughly half of those will be in Northwest Arkansas. Central Arkansas will see growth in leisure, hospitality, and healthcare. Fort Smith will look at more construction jobs with Umarex, or whatever that is. Umarex. A $30 million investment in Chaffee Crossing. In Chaffee Crossing facility, adding 76 manufacturing jobs, paying more than $20 per hour. $20 per hour, when it gets out, some people may see that as an opportunity if they just came to the city to work just for a paycheck. That's pretty attractive. So what it basically says is that they're starting to look at concerning yourself with, are we just competing against municipalities, or are we competing against that kind of industry moving in? I don't know yet, it's a little too early to tell, but we've had turnover in a lot of departments this year. The next one would be the interest rates and credit quality, and the reason I point this out has more to do with the interest rates, because we are going to be looking at bond financing. And instead of going out right now and getting a bond, instead of working with the bond managers and seeing what's coming down the road, they're projecting down at the bottom. I think the first thing I wanted to point out had to do with Arkansas was one of the states that did not have expanding economic growth. They had negative GDP, 1% to 5% as a result. A weaker than expected agricultural sector. It's projected that slower consumption of goods, that ought to worry you because that's city sales and use tax, and any kind of taxes that are based on sales, services, will occur in 2024 amid easing economic gains. Contributing factors include deteriorating credit quality for younger or youth consumers, increasing debt levels, and a drawdown of cash assets, meaning that they're giving into their savings and bank accounts and or cashing in some of their investments like stocks and bonds. The biggest risk to the state is the rising public debt levels and higher interest rates and lower nominal growth rates. Economists are, however, expecting the Fed to begin cutting interest rates by 1% mid-2024. So if we're looking at our cash flow need for the year pushed off into maybe later in the year, we can jump on that, and I'll be going at the recommendations of our bond manager companies that can provide some guidance on that. I did share with Ralph and Roger the fact that
gonna be bringing Stevens in. They're the second company to come in. They're gonna be talking with me about what they see as probably the best way in order to get the financing that's needed on the water side. We have already had some recommendations about a private placement bond, and the question would be whether we wanted to go with a 40-year standard or a 30-year standard bond, or whether we wanted to go with a private placement bond, and everything that would be in the water sewer would be collateralized with water systems revenue, because that's not a tax base for having to putting it out for a vote. We don't want to do anything to jeopardize that 1% permanent sales tax they already have. So I just wanted to give you that, and that feeds into my thought process on when we go after the bond.
But we'd also discussed, was an 8 or a 10-year bond?
10. A 10-year private placement bond.
Yeah.
It doesn't require us to go to get a rating. We don't have to go to the S&P to, you know, have them rate the bond. It's very quick and easy in order to do, and it's 10 years, and it saves a lot on your interest rate. Interest expense. Your debt service is over 10 years is a little higher than it would be spread out over 40, but at least you don't have that hanging over you with debt covenants for 40 years. So I know Fort Smith was looking at doing this, something very similar in their water sewer for laying lines, $651 million. Trunk line coming down from Fort Smith, I think is what they have. And they were balking, the city council or their board was balking at the 40-year bond. They said they didn't want to put that on the backs of the citizens for that long. It'd be ridiculous to finance something that long. Well, we, 2 weeks earlier, I already had the conversation with Raymond James on that very topic, and that's where we came up with the 10-year private placement bond. So we were already like 2 weeks ahead of their take on it. So now we get into our forecasted rates. This is what we have budgeted in your current budget right now is 4.5%, 4.5% for both county and 4.5% for city. That is a reduction from the 6% and 5% that we had before, or the 8% and 5%. We're down significantly because we're seeing that trend. So now what I want to show you is, what is that trend? Here's the city sales and use tax for January. Compared this January, percentage-wise, to the previous year, year-over-year Januaries, and what you're seeing is, and it pops up, this 5.2, negative 3, or 0.34. This 0.87, which was this year, this January, meaning November's collections, remitted to us in January, is the second lowest in all the years I've been here, which is the way I can put that. The second lowest. So this 0.87, if you go up to this amount right here, you're back at our levels that we were before COVID. And we were running an average of about 3% up to there. I'm thinking we're gonna probably be at maybe under 3, but hopefully not. Hopefully we'll rebound and we'll be back at 3. But I just gave you the economic outlook that was projected by the economists on Friday. And they're saying that you should be expecting lower consumer purchasing and lower spending. And they gave you all the reasons why. So I'm not bullish on this. I'm very apprehensive about whether we'll even hit that 4.5%. So the departments need to realize that, and we watch that trend, and we tread lightly on our capital spending. Cash flow is going to be the key. And that goes to all departments, not just water sewer. So let's look at county. County is really interestingly disappointing. Because what you're looking at now is that we ended up lower than we did in the previous. That is the first time since I've been here we actually went negative in our growth. So what it's saying is the city of Greenwood people are spending money in the city of Greenwood. All the rest of the county is not keeping up and not doing what they need to be doing. Or, because that's a per capita distribution, the growth in those cities are better than ours. And that's why we're getting less of a pot.
And you said these are November collections?
The monies that we received in January were collected for the taxes in November. Mostly November. So December hasn't come in yet, but they said the Christmas or holiday sales was up 3.1%. But what was inflation? 3.1%. So what it's saying is they're not spending more, they're not buying more, they're spending more due to inflation on what they normally would buy. Unfortunately, that's kind of what you infer in that. But that's very disappointing. So if you were to look up at that 8.86, you're looking at 1.8% if you roll it through the year, if that history repeats itself. So we should be looking more likely in this case, if that trend continues, we're going to be looking at probably 2.83. If we hit 3, I'd be amazed. I'm pleasantly surprised. So we may be readjusting that budget go forward on our first budget study session as we see what that trend is doing. But that's a little bit of an alarm there. And I saw today that Fort Smith's sales tax collections were also down. So now what I wanted to show you is our revenues. These are all of the operating departments and what the budgets are. You see general and admin. This would be 2023's actual and budget, and it's the amended budget. This would be the variance, and this would be our current budget. So we're budgeting a little bit lower, a little bit down on the revenue stream for operations, a little more conservative. The advertising and promotion monies, we're going to be presenting, we presented this to them in, I think, December? Yeah, December. We do it every 2 months, I believe. So I'm going to go to the water sewer line. You're going to notice the big increase down here, 6.49 million versus the 5.3 million. That is coming from the rate increases. We projected the water sewer rate increases into that. And the water sewer rates come through the water O&M department and the sewer O&M department. It does not flow through the city sales and use tax. So this is the average amount that you normally collect with the percentage 4.5 factored into that. That's what we collected. That's the increase based on the percentage growth that we project. All right, so if I go to the next slide, this is the sum of the, I couldn't put it all where you would be able to read it on one slide. So this would be the street department and the revenue stream for the street department, and you'll notice that the city sales and use tax for street and parks is $526,110, a little over $500,000. And not quite the $2 million that comes in on the 1% for the water department. But what you're gonna see is that on the operating department revenue stream, we budgeted 13.4, we came in at 13.4, 40,000 off of what we budgeted, which is a 0.3%. Growth variance. We're budgeting a little bit more now, 14.9, and that's a 10.59% growth, actual revenue over the budgeted revenues from 2020 budgeted revenues versus actual. So that growth, again, is coming from the 1.2 million or the 1.3 million that's factored in with the rate increases on water sewer, because they're an operating department and they are in this. So that's all in city. So that's with city sales and use tax, parks, city sales and use tax, streets, city sales and use tax, that's all factored in there. So if you remove the sales and use tax factors and you only go with the county sales tax, which funds operations, and the operating revenues, this $10,672,000 is the operating revenues of that 14.9. Or in other words, I skimmed off the 4.9 million, roughly 4.3 million, away from this to calculate what is the, how did the operating departments do revenue-wise. So we missed that. This was 9.3 to 9.1 million. We missed it by $250,000 or 2.64%. We're budgeting a 16.65% growth in the operating side because largely, that is the water sewers, because that's operating revenue. It's not tax revenue. It's sale of service and water to customers, so the residents of the city. So there's your revenue side. This is the expense side. Look, that's in your books. I will show you that one of the biggest factors here for the expense side on the operating department's budget is this line right here, which is the city sales and use tax water sewer. City sales and use tax right now, which this was the actual expense for this year, but $9.3 million, and all that capital improvements, that's it. Capital improvements is what's making up most of that, not the, not the hard assets. So they're looking at water treatment, sewer treatment plant, tanks, things that's gonna expand. Now, remember, if you're gonna grow the city, water sewer department is the department of dreams. It happens when they happen. They put it there, that's when development occurs. It can occur the other way, not as easy to do as it is if you have it ready for them to come in and operate. So that 9.3 million, though, is not necessarily all growth oriented. It has some growth in it, but a lot of it is infrastructure needs that have been, and I think sewer department is the biggest one that could help talk to this, has been, I'm not gonna use the negative term, which would have been neglected, but it's been not really taken in stride, taken care of over the last 11 years. They haven't had a rate increase. They were pretty much just going on, and didn't have any worries, and now they're at the point where they have to do things about their lines, their plant, their other lift stations, pump stations. All that's factored in that 9 million. Now remember, that is a $9 million outlay of cash for what they're saying is 2024.
What percentage of that is those type of things? Half?
Those types of things.
Growth-oriented
versus non?
Non-growth-oriented.
Non-growth-oriented? I can give you that. I'd have to go to the slides later, because you'll see what makes up that 9 million.
Okay.
That's, I have a two-part here. This is just the budget. But then I'm breaking out why we're going after the funding that we need for water sewer and what makes it up. You'll see every line item.
And that we want to go after when interest rates fall and the bonding later in 24.
Yeah, it's not a question of if, it's a question of when. Your rate increases that everybody's bearing right now for water sewer already includes debt service for the bonding that we're gonna need to do for the infrastructure that they're gonna need.
And that 10-year, you had a term for the 10-year one.
Private placement.
Private placement. Mm-hmm.
That's where a company comes out and says, I'll take that. We put it out for bid, and the private firm comes in and goes, I'll take it.
And that,
they grab that.
And if we go beyond 10, then we have to be, S&P has to look at our credit.
If you go
our
outside
rate,
of a private placement.
Then we have to go in and have a credit rating?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right now we're B++.
We're B++.
Correct. The city is. Their rating affects the city. It's our city bond rating.
And our rating would be balance sheet. They look at where we're at, debt service.
We were involved in the actual conference call with Standards and Poor's. They gave us a sheet that we had to fill out answering numerous questions regarding what's your contingency funds. How much do you have? What are your plans for this? What's your revenue stream looks like? How are you projecting it? What's your replacement reserve? They asked millions of questions, and we had to answer them in a way that didn't negate a lowering of our, or didn't provide for a lowering of our bond. We initially were looking at maybe an A+ or an A or an A-, but we ended up being plus because of something that came up. I don't know what it was. But the bottom line is, it's very intense. They ask all sorts of questions. And remember when I went back and I said that the debt, that rising debt that people have and now are carrying, we see that. I see it because I analyze the water sewer department's financials every month. And I can tell just by what I'm posting how many people pay their electric, not their electric, excuse me, their utility bill from water sewer with credit cards. It's enormous.
Really?
It's growing. So that right there is telling me if you're having to do that, that there's something is straining that that household income in order that they have to defer that payment.
And roughly what percentage of our bills are being paid that way?
That's drafts are the highest, so that comes right out of your checking account. It goes through the bank. The bank code is
When he said e-bill, is he talking about direct draft?
Yes.
Yeah, there's.
About a quarter.
It's kind of a direct draft. You go online and you pay it online and it comes out of your checking account. The draft is set up automatically. You don't have to do anything. Banco allows them to go online and pay each month when, and they choose the date they want to pay it. And they pay just like you would pay your bills online. So Banco is the provider that allows that. But it comes out of their checking account. But there's the draft, which people set up. They give us a copy of the check, we get their bank account information, and we on the 15th go grab the money and pull. So that's also coming out of your checking account.
But see, if I did it out of a credit card, I'd be doing it for points, not because I was strained.
That's true, but not a lot of people do that. We also looked at that. There has been a lot of discussion about that. It's not what's in your wallet. It was the change that's happening in, if I were doing that, I wouldn't do it with my utility bill.
Sometimes they give you triple points for it.
Cool. You keep doing that.
And you're saying that is growing.
It's growing.
Yeah.
The credit card usage.
I think if we, I'm not trying to cause you problems, Tom, but I think, I don't know. I do that. I've used a car. I've never paid a water bill in my life with cash. And I'm stressed as I've always been. But I don't think it means necessarily that, but go ahead.
It's a trend. That's all we're
saying. Exactly.
And so the trend
exactly.
is playing into the economists because right. they don't know why you're using the credit card. They only know the rising public debt is
right.
what is happening. So if people are what's in your wallet, fine. But it is a factor, is what I'm saying, in the strain that's on some of the people that are feeling the pain. Especially the fact that it went up, it'll go up when you start seeing the new bills that have been coming out. People go, ooh, that's a shock. Electric bills, utility bills. It's just a trend. That's what we're seeing.
Thank you.
We're still getting paid. All right. As far as the operating budget is concerned, the total expenses for all departments, $17 million is what we budgeted.
It's okay.
$13.7 million is what we came in at. We bettered our budget by 22%, $4 million. $25 million is our current all-in city budget. $25 million. And that's $8 million higher, and it's largely, as I've been telling you for all these slides, related to the water sewer infrastructure. So that's why that's in there. If you wanted to go and just look at what that does parlay into as far as our demand on funding requirements, this is your balanced budget. You get two of these. Okay. This is the sheet that the auditors pulled. This one right here. Because we are required to submit a balanced budget. In order to balance the budget, normally you would set this amount for your operating departments as your revenue stream, and you would say this column has to match that column. That's not what we do. Right now, what we're in is a situation where we have $11,119,000, so this is the availability of what's in the funds, and we draw from the available funds $223,000, then you see what departments we're drawing it from, netting it, and that gets us the revenue that we need in order to match the expense. Now that's operating departments, that's not all in. All in, it's this. So if somebody would said, what's your budget this year? It's $25,607,000. So this $14 million, we came in at 10, $25 million, but look where the largest percent of that is. It's in the water sewer department, as you see. And the other department that we have, you're going to see a need in, it would be the street department from $2 million to $4 million. I mean, from $2 million to now $4 million. I mean, in revenue, $4 million expenditures. So that's balanced as far as the budget is concerned right there. But it's budget, it's balanced because we're going to have to bring in $10,711,000. The majority of that's got to come from financing, as we've already talked about. Last is the fund balance as far as the, this is the, we have eight funds in the city, eight live checking accounts. Those are them. Everything else that we have that falls underneath one of those accounts, we call a virtual account or a sub-account. They're not real checking. So you can have negative amounts in certain sub-accounts as long as the funding in the main account is solvent.
this is showing 2,000,003. That's what it was at the beginning of the year, a little over $2 million. Right now, it's looking to be $2 million at the end of the year, but that includes the surplus cash generated from the shift of ARPA money to pay salaries for the police department. So this $2 million that's sitting down right here, this the city sales and use tax restricted amount, that needs this 972,000, which you guys did a resolution for to restrict to water sewer down here. So the bottom line is we started the year with 16, this was as of 12/31/2023, $16 million. If everybody does what they say they're going to do and we don't get the financing until next year, but that's not a possibility, we would be at $5,000,002. That's a 67% reduction in funds. Right there. That's, and there's the why we're going after probably $7 million, but it's going to be actually less than that. I'll show you why. Drop to the screen. This would be the water sewers amount where this unrestricted unassigned monies moved the 900,000 over, and it offset the $2 million that was up there, so now it's 1,108,000. That's what they're really looking at as a shortfall in that city sales and use tax restricted account. What you're going to see, though, is that it's roughly a little over about $6.2 million. That may not even be an accurate number. In some other discussions we had with water and sewer directors, there are some projects that are a little bit overstated and or won't be done. They'll be pushed out. And so we're looking to go back. I think that was a directive from the water sewer department chair versus the entire water commission. Told them to go, and we're going to sit down and we're going to look at some of the projects that could be potentially pushed out. So again, bottom line is the same. You're still looking at $5.2 million in the fund balance if we don't get the finance. We go after that $6 or $7 million, that $7 million less the funding, the debt service rather, that would be paid each year, we would have somewhere in the neighborhood of $6 million added to that $5 million, and that would give us roughly around $11 million all in the city, all in accounts. You're seeing a miscellaneous petty cash and escrow interest amount. You see $677,000 there, and you say that's awful high. Well, petty cash is in that, but there's also CDs for the sewer department. There's four of them that had to do with the sewer bond. All in all, it's over $400,000 that we're going to be moving back into the sewer O&M now because the bond's satisfied. So those are no longer needed, and they're on the balance sheet, and they are monies. They're CDs. We can go cash them in, bring them into the sewer department. Not the sewer. Yes, the sewer department. So that's where a lot of that money down here is. It's in that non-fund-related but outside revenue stream that we potentially have after bonds are settled.
Hey, Tom, real quick, we go back to that slide.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
that one. Yeah. So the note number one there was $201,704 for the sidewalk funds. Does that include the reimbursement that we're waiting on from the highway department?
Okay. We haven't gotten it, and that's not budgeted in. This right here, $15,100, that would be afterwards, that because we don't have any expense right now in sidewalk. I'll tell it to you now because it's in one of those bullet points on the first screens that I skipped over. We just got today from Jeff an estimate about 30% of the $1 million for doing the phase two of the sidewalks, and it's $430,000.
$450,000.
And that's estimating that instead of an 80-20, it ends up being probably about a 70-30 when it's all said and done. But the 430 is what you're anticipating being 2024's amount?
Yes.
Okay.
What you see up here in this column right there, that 186,604, that is only revenue that comes from the street department. They're funding that 150,000, plus your county sales tax goes into that, plus your permit sidewalk fees that go into that. So we budgeted the revenue side. We just don't have any expense in for what's going to be occurring in 2024 for the expense side. So the sidewalk fee is going to actually make it worse. That's going to deplete that revenue stream by roughly almost $250,000.
But we have not received the reimbursement from that.
We've received about two-thirds of it.
Okay.
Waiting on the final payment.
What's the final payment?
$200,000. Did you say okay?
Yep.
Okay, I was. All right, so that makes us focus on the street, though, because street's an issue up here. If you look at, street only has one account. It's the street department O&M. That's it. These three, street fund checking is the street fund itself. Then sidewalk falls under it as a sub-account, and city sales and use tax is not a separate account. It falls under the street department checking fund. So they started the year at $4,000,001. Right now, with their current budget, before we add the $450,000, if that's actually a cash flow issue for 2024, they're going to end at $1,000,007, which is largely just the street fund checking amount. They're going to be negative in their city sales and use tax, which we separate and keep separate for a reason, and the sidewalk fund for the 2024 budget. So the difference right now, and that's after expenses, what the difference is this $2.4 million in reduction of the street department's funds. And what you're going to see, I'm going to show you, well, I'll show it to you now. This is how they start the year. They started 2024 with $1.9 million and added $143,000 to that, so a little over $2 million. They are budgeting expenditures over revenues. Revenues over expenditures is a negative, $2.2 million, and they're going to end the year in 2024. If they spend all of that money, and that's the if, they're going to end up with negative balance of $97,000 in that account. So let's just carry on the, let's see what it does projects out for two more years, because they've already pushed projects out for 25 and 26. So the impact of the capital projects that are identified for 25, you start with a 97 negative. This is the revenue stream at 3% growth for city sales and use tax for 2025. We just assume we're going to get probably about that. And then we take out projected capital projects of 701,000, which is already on the books and it's listed in your budgets. And that'll put them negative at 257. That's overspending the revenue stream. And these are projects that essentially have to be done, and it's only going to get more expensive as you push it out.
And there's nothing that didn't reflect any carryover from 2023?
We were already negative if we do everything, so we're starting out negative.
You're starting out 24, 97,000 in the hole. That's
a good carryover. So, Tom, to address this, I mean, are you thinking that we need to go back and revisit the percent allocations for the city's sales and use tax?
You can't do that. It's all about election.
The percentage?
That's county sales tax.
Okay. Oh, this is cities.
This is city.
Okay.
This is voted on by the public. It's part of a three-quarter percentage.
Yeah.
City sales and use tax.
So you're saying that we may have to look at the 2025 capital projects then?
Let's go one step farther, because they pushed out projects in the current budget to 2026. So here it is. What you're seeing now is, let's carry that 257,000 over.
Thank you, sir.
So 26. Again, a 3% modest growth of city sales and use tax brings in about a little more than $550,000, and they have $3.1 million worth of projects at today's rates, today's cost, on the books for 26 that have been pushed out. These are projects that will have to be done. So what we're looking at is a $2.8 $1 million deficit by 26. And we've discussed this, saying, I warned this, gave you the warnings back 2 years ago on this, when I said street departments woefully underfunded. So in order to do these projects, which will be projects that will be dropped off, we'll have to do that, they're not educating business. So you're looking at probably having to go after some kind of financing on that. The problem you have is just being very, I'm being honest with you, this is the year that they're gonna be looking at that need. And 2026 is the re-up of the 25 cent order. Timing is terrible. Okay, this is the capital. City consolidated. We budgeted this year in 2023 $8 million in capital projects to be done in 2023. That $1.5 million, only $85,000, that's on the street resurface, and that's all engineering, is all it is. So, got the engineering done, now all I have to do is have the money to go out and do the work. So there's carryover on the street side. Then you look down at the capital improvement projects for the city. We budgeted $4.7 million and spent $1.5 million. You pretty much know this because I give you that report every month. So we ended up at $3,100,000 in capital projects done in 2023 on a budget of $8 million, or 39.27%. That's a big number for what I've seen year over year. Normally our carryover is getting a little higher. Now you're looking at the variance. This variance right here is the difference. That 4.8 is your carryover. That's what we're looking at having to do in 2024's budget. 4.8. Now remember, that does include water sewer in that. So now let's look at just water sewer. This takes everybody out except them. And it says they budgeted $4.5 million of the $8 million. So they're about 50% of the capital budget. And they spent 32% of it, $1.45 million. And this is $3,072,000 is the carryover. So of the $4.8 million, $3.7 million is water sewer. Got it? All right. And now we're into the payroll, and we've already gone through what all that means. So that's pretty much the state. Now, this is what you were talking about, the county sales tax. So when you look at the county sales tax, if anything that you do down here to make these numbers realign with some of the other general fund departments really does nothing. It makes the one department look good and operate, you know, without a deficit, but it takes away from another department that's in general, and it negates the impact to the bottom line in general. But if you move money into sidewalk, that's a whole different area. Everything else is general. If you were to move something like this 40,000 here, and you moved it up, let's say, to the Sebastian County Senior Center for their services that they do, right now they're paid solely from the general fund and not any money's coming to them from the county sales tax. But you'll look down, you'll see that the Sebastian Boys and Girls Club, Sebastian County Boys and Girls Club, that's funded that $51,000 for their operations right from county sales tax. And that's pre-distribution, comes right off the top. So if this $40,000 were taken away from the transfer to Lopping to help offset and defray some of the cost of the retirement from police and fire, and it put that solely back onto their budgets, they would have to bear that percentage or that portion of the $40,000 in their operating budget. So you're going to worsen two public service budgets because of that, but they're already getting a significant credit adjustment from the state. Question is, how long will that go on? We don't know. Hopefully for a lot longer period of time. And if you were to move this money, this $40,000 down to the sidewalk, you'd have an impact there that would benefit sidewalk through the street department because they're woefully underfunded. But for every action, there's a reaction. The reaction would be, it would be to the detriment of fire and police. Because you still have to stay within this 100%. percentage, let's say, from animal control, you know, is in a deficit. They get $93,000 here, but they've got $19,000 that they're taking away from the general fund because they're over, their expenditures exceeds their revenue stream right now. So if you were to adjust that percentage for animal control up, let's say to 4%, you would cover their amount, but you would have to lower one of these other departments here. And if you lowered parks, for instance, by that same amount that you're giving to, let's say, animal control, general's not affected at all. Because all you're doing is interdepartmentally fixing one budget and lowering another. So that's what I wanted to bring out about that. It only benefits if the general fund can absorb it and other departments can benefit from it. And the only other thing that you would look at is this pre-distribution stuff up here. If there's more of a need to go into this and general absorb that, that would be a discussion we could have at a later date. And nothing saying that that $2.7 million is actually going to come to fruition at the end of the year from what I just told you. All right. So now, if you're swimming right now with numbers, this is the water sewer capital spend. This is where you'll see the impact of our going after bond financing. The water sewer department started the year, they ended 23 and started 24 with $6.9 million all in. Everything you see up there is controlled, it's funds controlled by the water sewer department. What they're looking at doing, and that, by the way, was, what they're doing is they budgeted to lower them, their fund balance by 38%. They actually increased it by 1.1. So now they're starting to eagerly and aggressively go after fixing and repairing and doing what they need to do to the infrastructure because it's built into their rates. City Council and the Commission approved a phase-in approach to the rates. The phase-in approach, we were told by Hawkins and Weir, that literally will push out some of your capital projects a year because you're having to collect it in two phases. Whereas if you did it all at once, you would have the benefit of a lot more income in order to be able to do capital. But in that is factored in the bond. So the debt service is already in there, along with COLA, along with a replacement reserve for your current assets and needs for replacing those, along with a contingency for emergencies that no one could account for. That's all in that rate for 5 years. And then we renew it down the road. This is how we calculated the rate increase. Those of you that were here for the water wastewater budget study session, you would have seen this. 22% is the increase for the first year. So this was their actual revenue for 23. We take 22%, that's the rate increase. Add it to the average monthly billing, and that times 11 was 173,000 for the month. And so we did 11 plus the 1 month's worth of the old rate, because the rates that are in now we're collecting in February, not in January. We billed January in February, but we still collected at the old rate because you're billing for a month in arrears. So that's where we get the generation of the $2 million. So they're not increasing significantly on the water side, but in the sewer side, their rates went up 118%. So 767, using the same philosophy there, generates a 1.597 in revenue projection. We also did a sanitation increase projection at 5%, and that would be something that we'll be discussing with CARDS, and I think it's in June that that's going to actually happen, June or July, when their contract goes in and is re-upped or rolls over. And then we did the surcharge increase still at the water rate at 22%. So this is a normal year, $3 million. We're now looking at generating $4.2 million, mostly for the infrastructure that we need for this year. Remember, that's not enough to do $9 million worth of capital. That's why we have to have bonds. All right, so you don't need to sewer checking account is negative, at least it's looking like it would be budgeted negative. It won't be, we'll make sure we cash manage that. But these revenues, this money right here for the sewer construction and CDs and sewer bond CD and this sewer bond checking, that less the 35, that's over 400 and, well, right around $450,000 that would kick back into this sewer check, O&M checking once we convert it. So they should be fine. Now, as far as the city sales and use tax is concerned, there's that $972,000 that's going to come in. So if you take the 2080 plus the negative overspend plus the 972 dedicated, which right now is supposedly going to be used for removing our buried lines and stuff out of the easements for the Argotch bypass, you're looking at $1.108 million, which is what you saw in the other schedules. And then you look at the all in, if they we didn't get the bonding, if we didn't go after the bonding, their balance would be short if you added all of these up by $324,000. The problem we have is this city sales use tax fund balance and this water balance and this sewer balance, all of those are actual checking accounts. So they cannot run a negative balance. So we're going to have to make sure that we time this cash flow wise where the funding is available when the projects need to be paid. And then here you have the capital bonding scenarios. So this is the private placement bond that we're looking at. Okay, we have the cash fund balance at the beginning of 24 of $5 million. We're adding $2 million in city sales and use tax projected, and the general restricted amount of $972,000. You add all that revenue up, and then you subtract what they have on the books right now for their capital spend, and that would give us an unfunded capital projects of $1.2 million. That's the shortfall. By the way, that this amount right here, these two, includes this $3 million carryover. So we're looking at a private placement bond, 10-year, 4%. That number could change. That would be a $7 million bond, and then the debt service on that funded through water systems revenue would be $850,000. And so you're looking at us having a rather healthy CSUT going forward of $4.9 million. And that would be used for projects in 2025, 2026, 2027, all the way up to 2028. Along with the revenue stream of $1.2 million. Remember, you take that $4 million and add the $1.2 million, and then you kind of cash flow out your projects over the future years until you get to a new rate increase. And then this would be a secondary way of looking at it. But private placement bond looks pretty good because you don't have this 40 years looming, and you don't have a bond rating having to deal with. And you're looking at a $660,000 debt service, and you would be bringing over 5.1. So if you're looking at a 5.1 versus a 4.9, I'd take the 10-year before I would do anything. I mean, it just makes sense. I would give up that additional for the lower length of period.
Can you go back to that other slide, Tom?
Oh, this one?
Yeah. 660.
It's lower because of the period of time. There's also another thing you have to think about. The water bond, sewer doesn't have it, but the water bond is still in force, and it's going to be in force until 36. So 2036 is when that matures. Now, there are call dates, and we could factor in refi on that. We'll have to see how that plays out as far as the debt service is concerned, but I'm going to let the bond managers give the recommendation for that.
When you're saying that, though, are you saying that balance after the bond less debt service we have available $5 million a year?
No.
Over that,
it'll be at the time we get this. That's assuming we get that bond this year. And one thing you have to realize too is that this debt service 1 year, that's assuming we got the bond already, because we're looking at this being a whole year. So if we don't get it until the end of the year, this debt service drops to how many ever months you're incurring the debt. So you'll be carrying over more.
So when you go back to the other slide, then we have available Well, I look at, we have available, you know, almost 5 million again, but when you say that private placement's 10 years, that's really like 500,000 a year, basically, then, right? Available to us?
Well, you gotta remember, you're bringing in every year $1.2 million in your city sales and use tax. That doesn't go away. Doesn't sunset. So, you know, you add that revenue stream to the amount you carry over every year in that city sales and use tax fund. And then that's how we cash flow then. And we've projected, we've done the cash flow over here. We projected the cash flow over 5 years. This year was the only year we're gonna make it. So that's why we're not rushing right out to go and get it done. I would be happy. I would be ecstatic. Because I told you that we've never even done 50% of what we budgeted. I'd be happy if this right here all got done this year. Just 3 million of that. 8, 9 million. Just three of them. We would take care of every project that's on our books, that's been on our books for the last couple of years. We've only spent 50%, and we could move off into 25 or bond funds. That's how that would work. But I'd be ecstatic if we hit that mark right there in the water side.
On the water side.
On the water sewer side, yes. Because that's both water sewer.
And so I'm saying again, though, with the debt financing, you know. We would, though, still have in addition to, like, saying we bring in 1.2, we'd have an additional roughly 500,000 a year to that 1.2 for capital projects and stuff.
Well, I guess I see what you're saying, but this is not coming in. This is actually going out.
That 660,000 is, right.
Yes, sir. Per year. There's going to be $9 million worth of projects just for what they're considering now. But here's what I wanted to show you. This is what it makes that up. And it's really over so in this case, this is the proposed capital projects for water. This is water. Yeah. So you're looking at the years right here that they're looking at these projects being incurred. So 2027, they're looking at $6.7 million. Just on their side. This year we budgeted $3 million. So I've got to account for another $3 million rolling forward over the next 4 years. Okay.
Those aren't installed, those will run around. There'll be some, maybe less money with higher priority, maybe more money.
And I'll let you talk about this one, water treatment plant improvements, which was budgeted at the largest percent of $3.6 million. And when we presented this and showed it to him in the budget, his first comment was, what is that?
I was told by the engineers that we were looking for future rates. What do you think you'll need in the years to come? In the next 5, even 10 years. And I told him things that could break down. They will need to be replaced, chlorine dioxide machine, things as much as fixing a clarifier, it leaks, that's not really expensive. They have a lot more in there than that.
But for them to really, for us to go and get that $7 million, though, they really were looking things to justify why we needed $7 million. Okay. So we may not necessarily hit that 3.6, but they were just saying, just worst case scenario, if everything just happened that we needed it, you know, that'd be like around 3.6.
6.7 million, though, is what was put into the rate projection. So that's on the backs of the citizens. So it will likely come to pass, just not right now. And that's why we have to cash flow that. I mean, we're sitting down, and you had a budget issue that you were going to mention that will factor into this, which potentially is an increase of $400,000. So there's gives and takes. There's some things that are going to come in way higher than what's up there, and then there's what he was talking about, things that can be moved.
To me, you put things down, if you have the time and the money, very likely, even if we have the money, there's not enough time in the year to get the things accomplished. You get them engineered, you get them out from bed and get them done. But you have a list that you work on. So they're not in stone, but you have to have a plan and a direction to go. And as and again, priorities change. You know, what was important today, you know, something else may pump the scotch ahead of it and become more important. But yeah, we had an increase, but and then we'll also we're looking for solutions for that. We may come up with a better idea and a better cost saving. You know.
Well, the other thing is, Tom, I mean, let's say we do this one, you know, we get the 4% or thereabouts, you know, 4%. Doesn't say that we, 3 years from now, if rates do go down or whatever, that we can go back and try to refinance that at a lower rate.
Private placement bond over 10 years, not sure what they'd put into that to guarantee their investment, security of their investment. I know that when you refinance the sewer, they locked you in and said you cannot pay it off early, because they were protecting that 0.5% interest that they were adjusting to for cash flow reasons. And anytime you refinance something, if you do go to bond debt ratings companies where they have to rate you, that's a negative indicator to you, because you're refinancing for cash flow purposes. And they're saying there's something wrong if you're having to do that. That's the way they'll look at it. It's kind of a negative one. But it's like you're hearing, it's a hit or miss. We're going to have to cash flow manage when we've got to have to make sure that the money's there when they need it there. And that's a tall task for as much as they're trying to spend. That's just the water side. This is the proposed capital projects on the sewer side. 6.9 million comes from all of that. Is there anything you want to point out? No?
All my problems are right there.
Hmm.
What's WWTP? What does that stand for?
Wastewater Treatment Plant.
Oh, okay.
I knew that. Well, do I have to form it in the form of a question? What is wastewater treatment plant?
So the other one was water treatment plant, and this one is wastewater treatment plant. So they're both kind of like 3.6 or somewhere in there. I mean, this was 3.9. The other one you said it was like 3.6. No, well, just when he was throwing out there that proposed, you know, he said we may not do it all, but it was like 3.6. Well, so they're both kind of.
This is going to happen.
Yeah, this wastewater treatment plant project, this has to happen. We put under great investment by being a couple of years ago.
It's climbed a year for a month and goes to Cancun for 2 years.
Some of those problems, there's been a lot of issues with treatment plant itself just due to age. It hasn't had anything done to it since it went online in 2001. So we've got a lot of stuff that's just using Wi-Fi there, and we've got new state requirements. So that's what that 3.9 million is. Now, Tom alluded to the possibility of shifting things around. As part of my budget this year, there's $2.5 million in there to get that project started. There's possibly $1.2 million of that that we can push into 25 to meet cash flow demand, so we can stay solvent for a year or two.
Is any of those improvements increasing capacity, or just be maintaining?
Just getting compliance.
No, none of that's
just getting compliant.
One of the issues we have, which I did speak to engineers about increasing capacity of the plant, is half the year, meaning three times a
Capacity could always mean growth, you know, in our population, growth in our community.
In the sewer business, capacity is infiltration, your heavy maintenance.
Okay.
Now, there are some other things that we're looking at.
That's Indian Hills is infiltration, right?
Yeah, Indian Hills, Shadow Lake, and the old part of town. I mean, it's a lot of lake. We're all looking at some future projects possible. Special type of fire park system at the plant to stem some of that excess flow when we do have high flow events. But in the short term, I'm just focusing on issues that we need to get resolved because the state's pretty high.
From the water we produce to the water we treat, ideally it would equal, be the same, right? Nope.
Now what?
From the water we produce at the... Well, that's what I was getting at. What, how much more are we treating to go back into the, how much wastewater are we treating compared to what we're making and selling?
During the summer, during drought, what we treat the sewer plant is a small fraction of what we buy and produce, maybe half, maybe more than that. But during those rain events, maybe 8-10 times what we give the sewer plant a day, what we buy and produce, water is plus.
And a lot of that would be fixed with Indian Hills.
A little bit. We've got a lot of leaks more just in Indian Hills.
Okay.
You got a lot of water yard.
But it's not gonna solve all of our problems. We got hit with 8.2 million gallons coming to the sewer plant on June 10th of 2022. Probably 4 million of that came from the old part of town, not Indian Hills and not Shadow Lake. That's not a normal day, but we have a lot of leaks a lot of places.
When you say old part of town, you're considering up by the school, Houston?
Everything that goes into lift station one that doesn't go into lift station two. Lift station two is constrained by only 8-inch force main, so in a 24-hour period, you're going to probably get 1.6 million gallons through that 8-inch main. The rest of it goes into the creek. We have a 15-inch line on the east part of town with gravity flow. On heavy flow day, that might get 2, 2.5, so we're not really sure. It's kind of hard to calculate gravity flow. That means that everything restricted lift station 2, lift station 1, is over 4 million gallons that day from leaks in the older parts of town. A little bit on Coker and a lot of Main Street, between the two creeks mostly.
Okay.
It's a lot of money. And there is a attention to the detail. We are looking at making sure that the revenue's there. I didn't want you to believe that $5 million is going to be a reality. It's really not. We have a plan in place in order to be able to address it. We've got that water systems revenue rates fixed. So hopefully there won't be as significant of an increase in 5 years from now. We are building for that future. One of the things we won't have to deal with is a lot of the infrastructure repairs and needs that are in place now. We're going to probably be looking more at them in the future on the next 5 year period. So that's why I don't want to go 40 years on bond, because what's down the road as far as growth continues.
What is the time schedule? Is it looking like, you know, we might get this bond? Or are we looking at it for the end of this year, or?
Let's recap. We're looking at probably if we do anything, it's going to be driven by their cash needs. In other words, they are more aggressively doing their capital projects than what I'm thinking they're going to be doing, because there are certain factors that are out of their control. Has to do with supply chain issues or materials that even the contractors that would come in and do the work, because they don't necessarily do the work that's jobbed out. So there's a lot of environmental factors. So I don't know when they're going to need that cash, but we're working with them, and we're going to be working to the point where if it is necessary for us to do it this year, we will pull the trigger and do it.
going to watch the interest rates and go by what the experts are telling me as far as the Fed rates, how they're assigning that raising or lowering. And then we're going to pull the trigger when we need to pull the trigger. I can't say it'll be the end of this year. I was really hoping to target next year for it to be done.
Well, I guess I was just wondering, I guess, when you get ready to pull the trigger, I mean, is it a process that you can do it like within 30 days, or you need 60 days, or you need 90 days?
So it'll be quick. Yeah. It'll be relatively quick. If I can, it's probably a 3-month period I would have that we would have it set up with the bond managing bank.
So in passage of this budget, you have the trigger where you say, today's the day, you can do it. Well, if it was their need, it's time to pull the trigger, and the interest rates were where they should be.
I follow what you're saying. I thought you said I would just.
I'm just.
No.
No, I wouldn't. I would wait until I know they're in need. And don't think I don't watch the water budgets. I mean, they get a financial report on their water budget every time they meet, and they know where their money is, and they knew what was moving. They have a 10-year plan. And beyond. So this is why, because I need to be able to say what is your revenue stream compared to what your needs are as far as potential capital improvement costs. And this is the day we have to, I just wanted to show it to you. This is what we look at. And now you see it in the nutshell. Now we can go back, because we're done with the city finances. I want to go back to the list. Now you're at number 3. Okay? We've already addressed 1 and 10. So number 3, I just wanted you to know that in the budget we had Arivac at $65. Just for transparency purposes, when we finally got a hold of them, Danielle found them, a lot. Finally got a hold of them and they said it's $75 per employee and volunteer. That's an impact of about $1,200 to the budget. Just wanted you to know that number will be different than what you saw in your budget study session. So if you don't have a problem with that, we'll input that into the budgets, and when you approve it, you're going to be approving it with all of these discussed items, and I'll give a sheet where you can print it off, Charles, so that you know these will be inputted into the budget. Water, sewer, protective clothing allowance is $400 per employee. That was decided upon based on the need for the work they do during major storms, cold weather, ice, snow, whatever, they have to get out there and work. So that's what they put into the budget. It's $1,600 per department in most cases. I think 24, 26?
I think 24 was, you got more employees.
More employees is what it was. So we're giving them that allowance for them in the budget. That's what they want in that budget.
So how much is that going to be?
$5,600. Spread amongst 4 departments.
Is that in on their paycheck and payroll?
It's an allowance.
Yeah, I discussed with Tom was possibly doing a reimbursement, raise the receipt. We'll fill that form out. Tom can find his department.
That's why I would prefer it.
Yeah, they didn't want it taxed.
Seems good.
It's a reimbursement. Then the next one is the street department had budgeted in your budgets an asphalt heating machine, and that increased on a quote that you just received from $72,000 to $78,000, or a $6,171 increase on that piece of equipment. So, in transparency, to be transparent, we just didn't drop it into the budget afterwards. We said, well, you approved it. Well, that
intention, so that when you approve the budget, I'll have permission to make that happen in the budget. So, do you have any?
Is everybody familiar with what that is from the street budget night? Okay.
And then number six is the flooring replacement for City Hall. I'll let you take that one.
Yeah, we talked about this for a couple of years now, but everything in here is, no better word to say it than just nasty. We've had this carpet cleaned, I don't know the last time, but anyway, it's been cleaned a few times. It's pretty ragged. I mean, it's not anything we can't live without. I think whatever, it's just something we've been talking about. So we have two quotes, one quote, and we're working on two other quotes. The $50,000 was just a placeholder to say, in this, we would like to do it. We'd like for it to be that or less, but we don't know the other two quotes aren't in yet, and it's to
if you don't want to spend that much, it would be good if we could at least just get them on early.
Yeah, there's the public bathrooms are kind of embarrassing, to say the least, in my opinion. I don't go in the ladies. I have been in there, but to check the floor, but that's bad. I think that's a need. That hallway over there on that end of the building is daily for citizens to go down and visit with Parks Commission. I mean, I'm sorry, planning and the parks. The other hallway, not so much, but that is, the intent is to do everything except my office, Danielle's office, in that whole area where the PD used to be, everything else except for this tile in the foyer. That's
closets,
but everything else except for we're going to keep the tile out front, of course.
Is there going to be carpet in here?
Well, we're getting a carpet price. We have, the first quote gave us a carpet price, I believe, and we didn't, I thought we got a tile. So it hadn't been decided.
Carpet would be good for the acoustics.
The acoustics, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So probably, but we don't. Huh? Yeah, I know. I absolutely agree. So probably. I just didn't want to say absolutely.
Yeah.
And you can address acoustics with acoustic tiles, blah blah blah. So, but more than likely.
But this is a quarter century old, this building.
It's
so it's
the
kind
carpet's
of
bad. It's bad.
Oh, are we swapping that expenditure for the marquee, or we're keeping the marquee in there? And
good, the marquee is out because I have not gotten any new information from RDOT. We could certainly do that. We talked about taking $15,000 or so from the marquee price and leaving it in for two more. I'm trying to do two wayfinding every year, but we don't have to do that. In fact, we haven't put up we haven't even got the last two installed. They're wet. Yeah, they're waiting on some breakaway bolts or something. So that's a possibility to just swap that out.
You're saying, is everything in here original?
Yeah, except for my office. And the PD, that section where the PD was redone when we refurbished it for my office, Danielle, in the conference room. Everything else is original, my knowledge.
If Roger would have done a better job the first time he was here,
I agree,
we wouldn't be back revisiting this.
That doesn't have to be bid out, does it?
I don't know, but we're getting quotes.
I was going in.
Oh, you were?
Yeah. I think it does. Okay,
maybe. Yeah, I was going in.
Oh, I'd like
anything
to amend
over
that.
Four, is it 35 or 50 now?
35. And then 50, 75 or 50 for permanent structures.
I don't know. But we just decided to get quotes just to be.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, so if I'm for the six, if we swap it out for the marquee, I mean, that would just be a swap.
So it's out. It wouldn't be. Yeah, you wouldn't. You'd be adding it. You'd be putting it in instead of the marquee. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. So seven.
The budget numbers that you already saw are including, does include that $50,000, and it includes the everything except the air evac fees are in the budget numbers that you have. Disclosing that it changed since your budget study session.
Yeah.
And number seven.
I've asked before. It was $150 a couple of years ago. That was not buying a good pair of boots. And if you've been to buy boots, you know. And so this year I ask again. And $250. I asked that we raise it to $250 to get these guys the boots they need. That's simple as that. The Senior Citizen Center, they came and asked for, I don't know if she's been back.
No, it's 36.
Okay.
Not
okay. She came back for an increase in money to provide what they already provide, the cost of meals.
She said that, I believe she said something about, there's about 60-ish residents just in Greenwood that are on the waiting list to get in.
Yeah.
But, shut-in.
But it is 36, right?
They want $1,000 more.
Yeah.
They haven't, since I've been here, I think it's been 2,000 a month. I don't think they've made any.
No, yeah, that's right.
So they're asking, they said it would help because the large percentage of increase comes from their packaging for the meals that they take out.
Yeah.
That's where the cost went skyrocketing. And the dollar doesn't go as far, so they're not able to provide as many meals, thus putting City of Greenwood residents who need that service not able to get the meals.
Yeah. And I don't think she even mentioned fuel, but we all know fuel's gone up since in a year or two, so.
I think when we presented this, you guys said that you would revisit it later as you saw what it was doing.
Yep. So. Nine is the possibility, and I know there's some work to be done, some discussion. Our city attorney is looking at, I think everybody was kind of on the same page as far as a donation and or trade of property for the Masonic Lodge. He's still working on it to find out what's the best and not most legal, but the right way to do it. And so by doing that, we talked about also the street department, if you will, building a parking lot on the more north southern lot and the building being on the northern lot, and that parking lot being utilized for the Masonic Lodge, obviously, but for downtown shopping and things, and the what we already own
on Atlanta side.
Atlanta, yeah.
So those two lots kind of surround the Dawson School building?
Yeah. So we don't have a paver, as you know. We're not paving business. We got out of that a long time ago, but this would we're asking for, and I don't know what that amount is. Do we have an amount?
No.
Okay.
Do we have a possible amount? A ballpark amount?
The labor, is the labor. The cost will come in on the
material.
Amount of material that we have to take out.
And then at one point.
That's unknown really until we get in there.
Of course, at some point you don't want to asphalt that, so.
So we're talking.
Bring it up to where all you have to do is come in and have a blacktop and you're done. No other work will have to be done to it once we get it.
But I mean, are we talking about 100,000 possibly or
no,
50,000
so.
Or?
No, I would ask Casey now if you know numbers out at the lake parking lot.
I was going to say around 75.
Okay, and that was materials and labor. So, and I haven't asked the county this yet. I'm kind of going to put them on the spot a little bit with the new judge and see if there's some possibility of their assistance with paving as they did at the lake. I can't imagine that being a no. I don't want to promise that. But.
I think it was only $9,000-something, and we were really surprised. The lake. Remember that paving of the lake?
To the county?
Yeah.
It was material only.
They charged
material only to asphalt that parking lot.
Remember the new judge made that a no.
I know.
On the new
I know, but we're seeing him, quote unquote, loosen up a little bit. But I want to make, that's not official. That's not official.
So, I guess so. We're looking at possibly around 75,000. High estimate. Okay.
Ten, FEMA. This is the one that Hunter's been working on diligently. We got the grant, or we've been approved for the grant, and so I'll let him talk about it more than me. He knows. I'm in on the conversations, but he's been in charge of this. The estimated, as you can read, for our portion of that is $350,000. Is that seven homes, or do we?
That's what I estimated.
Just estimated of that. Okay. So that's on the horizon. I mean, I think we don't know for sure that that's even going to be distributed this year, or do we already?
I got an email today. I didn't get to read it fully. It was forwarded to you and Tom.
Okay.
But they did forward it to us.
Right.
I got the email today.
Okay. I think, my opinion, that's going to be going kind of, my opinion only, if once it's the paperwork's done, it'll kind of go. So I kind of half expect it to be this year, but I could be wrong.
Okay, stop you
yep,
there.
Yep.
Number 9
mm-hmm.
and number 10 that you just discussed, neither one of those are in the budget.
Right. Yeah.
So,
yep. 11 is an estimate for phase 2 of the sidewalk project center. 450, as you heard, for the 30%, right,
yep.
of what we're thinking is $1 million.
But you think that's all this year, 24? You think we're going to spend that? When do you anticipate?
I mean, I would really, I'd really like to get it done this
so,
year.
So it hinges upon, is more than anything, are the easements. And from
kind of
from what I understand, RDOT, RDOT is giving, this is not, RDOT has some questions for Jeremy, who has designed this project, about certain things, and they're making, and they're changing a few things. Now, they have already changed the project name. It is no longer 10 Spur, blah, blah, blah number. It is Center Street, because that's now ours. So I'd like to see, with the name change, a little bit less stringent. I want it's going to be safe, don't get me wrong, but I think maybe they'll let up a little bit on the restrictions.
We may not have to obtain as many easements.
Yeah.
We don't have to adhere to the RDOT standards and keep the sidewalk a minimum of 14 feet.
That's what I'm trying to say.
So your easements will be easier.
Yep, that's what we're saying.
And Daniel has resigned from easement getting, so.
So,
but that, I'm with Jeff. I think, and I'm thinking positive, but anything can happen. Yeah, I think it ought to be in there.
How long did it take you to get easements last time?
Yeah.
A year and a half or two? He ain't going to spend it.
Well, understand, several of those were out of state.
They were.
And we had some.
Worked very diligently.
And we had some no's. He already has the list of. Yeah, he already has the list of who they are, and at first glance, and I anything can happen.
The majority of them are owned by people here. Mm-hmm. I think there's only one or two that are.
Which, if you want to, you could take that information and go, well, the only one that was owned by Greenwoodian before was a dead no.
Yeah.
For right. quite some time.
Yeah.
I don't foresee that, but you don't know till you ask. So.
Well, would we be more apt to, with the. Travis, to do an eminent domain? If it drags on and stuff, instead of letting it drag
we
on?
We talked about that even with the phase one, and it, but of course, by the time we kept talking about it, it was already almost 2 years, a year and a half. So I'd like for him literally to take a stab at it and see what we can, technically, I don't think we can even discuss it with them yet,
no,
legally.
I've already gotten
but you. So,
I'm thinking with the delay, though, our participation went from 2080 to more like 3565.
Absolutely, cost of everything went
yeah,
crazy.
Yeah, it was costly.
Yeah.
55-45.
Now, I will say, and I'm not. This is not bad mouthing anybody. It's just a fact. Our previous attorney was here when we were doing that. Correct.
Yes.
He had no. We couldn't. He didn't want to do that. This one might, I don't know, but certainly we would consider that as we start the process.
So who's point man on easements this time?
Hunter.
So during councilman forum, I'll ask every month.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just like last time I did for 3 years.
Yep.
So, Danielle, you did a good job.
She did. It's the reason she don't want to do it this time. Okay. 12, and I'll tell you some of the biggest questions and or things that RDOT's kind of giving Jeremy a hard time are the bridges. I literally read this on one of the emails. It said, "We will not." I'm paraphrasing horribly. We will not allow you to bring pedestrians up on the bridge to walk, blah. And then it said, "You have to bring pedestrians on the bridge." I'm like, this. They just basically said the same thing, except. You can or you can't. It was the strangest thing I've ever seen.
I think there's a snowball's chance that it happens in 11 months because we got 11 more months out of the year.
So is the 450 in the budget or not in the budget?
No.
If so.
I just found that out about now.
Okay.
Yeah, he didn't know until just.
So like I said, but it's definitely going to be probably.
I mean, we can always, as we move, as he progresses, we can come back at your quarterly meetings and say, okay, well, we got a green light, and we got how many are there?
I think there's 13.
13 easements. We're ready to rock and roll.
How many?
13. So, I mean, I don't have heartburn with it being held out, I don't think, until we get.
It was another one of those, Tom and I were discussing, to bring to your attention
right
now.
I think it's easy enough. I think it's easy enough to bring it back, especially with the situations that we're in with other funds. 12 carryover from added 2024 Parks A&P budget, Second Bridge, Liberty Park.
There's just an oversight on my part.
Oh. I will give a sad announcement. We did get rejected on the grant. He applied for a grant, just so FYI, he applied for a grant for the old iron bridge, the oldest iron bridge, or one that's been on the lake. We didn't get it.
That was State Park grant?
That's a blessing.
Was that a State Park grant?
Park, yeah.
Well,
as we all know, the other one was tough and hard, and right, Councilman McDaniel. But this, we didn't get a grant on it. That doesn't mean, but it did say apply again. So just to let you know.
I meant to ask: was there money in the budget for in the parks for the Ozzie Louise dock and the groundwork leading to the dock? I mean, there's a lot of washout going down to that dock, and then I noticed some holes in it. You know.
We can make that happen with some money. Okay.
13 is I remembered it today. Believe it or not, we had at one point, I don't know, it was last year, year before, we had $10,000. You guys allowed 10 grand in there to purchase the trolley. I got the trolley donated, as you know. A&P allowed 10 grand to wrap the trolley, and it is amazing. It's finished except for the dash. I mean, it literally looks a brand new. It's very impressive. We have to do the inside, which the street department has taken that project on. I'm asking for the 10 grand that was originally there to purchase it that we never spent to be put back in there for repairs and whatever we might run into. It runs. We've used it already, but the interior needs to be redone. But I don't think – I hope we don't need that much because I'm putting it on them to do it.
And that one is in the budget too, 10?
No, it is not.
I just found out about that.
Oh, okay.
It was last year, and we took it out because I got it donated.
You redeployed it.
Yeah. Is that all of them?
Yep.
I think so. Okay. And then you have the budget in its entirety. So.
Yes.
So right there again, when you're looking at the budget, you send the, I guess, I was kind of looking where you said, we actually budgeted and then the expense.
Where it crossed.
Yeah. And so I guess, so are we crossed higher in 2024? Are we breaking even or?
Well, we'd have to calculate the actual. I don't have the actuals. I know what, you know what the budget is, but they never hit that budget as I showed you on these. That's the budget normally, and this year's no exception. 2024, where are you?
Go to the right.
Go to the right. Oh, there it is. This right here will probably be like way up here because of the capital needed for water and sewer, as you know. But the revenue stream will still be budgeted below. Because remember, I showed you, we're just operationally, we're like $111,000 going, $200,000 coming in from operations in order to balance. On the other side, we're $10 million short with all in cities to balance the budget. So that's going to still look like that in 24. Now, here's the deal, though. When you go to 24's actual, this is what we're anticipating happen because we're aggressive in our
And I was just wondering, with the graph that you were talking about, you know, our what was coming in for January, you know, do you feel still pretty confident that with what you told us about the economy and everything, 4.5 is still a pretty good for both the county and city? That's why you paid the big bucks.
Not a trend made, and I would like to see the Christmas results first, which is December's revenue collections, which comes in February. I want to see if there's a rebound in that first. You know, we could always rebase it after each quarter if you wanted to. If you think it's no way we're trending way lower, we could adjust it so that they know that that money would not be available for their operations and they have to adjust their expenditures. This is the one that operationally bothers me more, Josh. Because that's not your capital, that's your operation. It affects all of the departments in general. Parks, police, fire, animal control. We have turnout.
Okay, I'm not sure how you as the council want to proceed with the information you have. You want to?
Do we have a resolution?
Oh.
Yeah, we
what?
Do.
Charlotte has it?
She's just, yeah.
Well, we're supposed to.
When we,
when we talk about.
I think you've got paper copies of the resolution.
Where are they?
Now, did every group get a 2.9 COLA increase? And I was wondering, did because I didn't see it's part here for the councilman. Is that a two? It is in there. Okay.
Go to the general budget. Go to the general budget.
Did he come? You got it. You got the new one. Says,
well, there's no resolution to adopt the budget.
Yeah, a resolution.
Oh, okay.
For the salary range.
Sorry.
Okay.
Sorry.
You don't get, we don't have.
Okay, I guess we'll find out in a minute.
I didn't
see to adopt
that.
The budget resolution.
Oh, one other thing I was wanting to.
No,
we'll
I didn't
find out in a minute. In the.
Who's looking for?
Yeah.
On this expense here, 63 professionals. Also, we had a big high, 50,000.
Let's all say your name at the same time.
Was that just a one-off?
53,290. That's
professional. Yeah, I was wondering what.
Miss Derry, is there a resolution to adopt?
Oh, the. Okay.
We do.
For the.
I mean, they're asking things.
Okay. I thought it had to be some type of one-off. You know, it's just this. Okay.
She's gonna go get it.
I can't really say we're up to pretty close to $500,000.
Any other concerns, questions about any of these departments or anything?
Dang it. The very last thing they talked about.
The trolley?
Yeah, the trolley.
Yeah, he would get cold.
Yeah, he'd get the cold.
Tom, has anything been added that wasn't discussed in previous meetings other than the list?
No, that's why I did that list.
The Air Force.
They came to me after the budget.
Money into the thing, and hopefully the sales tax will still be up. We're still kind of worried about that.
They did some minor changes to some of the errors that were in there, but it was like one of the police officers didn't have COLA.
That's exactly true.
So I had to add the COLA, but that's
the presidential election.
Yeah.
So we had to make those changes to the errors in there, what their base salary was or something.
Kind of worried about.
She went to get the resolution to adopt. Yeah.
The suspense is just.
I know. Is it gonna be on colored paper or is it gonna be?
She goes to the old one.
Oh, okay. I do wanna make a announcement to just FYI. I was visiting with, started with Chief Baker in Fort Smith, went to Carl Geffigan, or went to Kevin Settle, then Carl Geffigan, and then full circle back to me. I asked for it. You don't ask unless you ask to get. Anyway, we have been donated by the city of Fort Smith per those three gentlemen anybody. We're getting a freezer, walk-in freezer. The PD bought, the Fort Smith Police Department bought the Whole Hog restaurant that went out of business. They're gonna turn it into a satellite police station, if you will, substation. And I immediately asked the chief when he was, Chief Baker, when he was telling me, I said, what do you have that's left over that I can purchase? Anyway, all that stuff. I got a call from Mr. Geffigan the other day and they're donating that walk-in freezer. So Jeff and I are going up tomorrow to inspect and see what it's gonna take to remove it and bring it down. This is for the Senior Citizen Center. Those things can, it's pretty good size too. They, if it works properly, it could easily be a $10,000.
Thank you.
Donation or more.
Thank you.
And Mr. Geffigan said to me, since we have a good relationship with the city of Greenwood, we would like to make this donation. So. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. $15.25. And while I'm there, I'm going to put my sticky note on every piece of equipment in the restaurant tubes. I would imagine, yeah. They are keeping the pit. The yeah, he said they're going to use that. I don't know. Let's find out. So there's your resolution. Thank you.
Close to adoption it?
They just asked to see it. So. Any thoughts, counsel, on the resolution before you? I'm not trying to rush you. I'm just.
I make a motion we adopt.
Have a motion and a second to adopt.
The call vote? Mr. Brown?
Yes, please. I'm sorry, call vote.
Yes.
Mr. Meeker?
Yes.
Mr. Rainwater?
Yes.
Mr. McDaniel?
No.
And Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Passes by majority.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Ms. Derry.
Welcome.
Mayor, I would like to say one thing.
Yes, sir.
I would encourage all department heads to pursue grants. I mean, research, you know, chase after these things. I mean, there are monies out there in each of your departments through state, federal, non-government organizations. Look into that. I mean, that money is gonna go to somebody, and it might as well be us. I know Parks Department has done a great job going after grants. We've got grants through PD, the fire department. There's all kinds of grants out there. And so I would just encourage you guys and gals to continue to do that. Because like I said, that money's gonna go to somebody. It might as well be us.
That's one thing I do appreciate, you know, you going and getting with Wapaditi to see how they broke down and everything. I mean, that was very informative to me, and I'm thinking that is a great resource. I don't know if they are actively pursuing on our behalf, or do we approach them? That's when they.
And the floodplain, we have to let them know what we're wanting.
Okay.
I mean, they always have their eyes for grants, but specifically, if Jeff needs or whoever needs something, we let them know, and then they go after for it.
For one, for the Historical Society, I meet with
Tracy McKinnon is pretty awesome.
She's their grant person, so they're pretty good at helping us get those grants.
Good, well, like I said, I just.
I mean, not all grants are worth it, let me say that. I mean, you know, you might just, yeah, spend $1 million to get $10,000, but I mean, there are some out there that are definitely worth it. And if it's free money.
And I appreciate you saying that. They hear me say it about once a month. But I appreciate that.
We have another thing.
Sorry?
Salary schedule.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry, we have not, the second item on here, sorry, is resolution amending resolution number 123-03, adopting official salary range schedule to adjust for the COLA.
Do we have that with?
Yes, sir. This is the one I was, yeah, it's here.
Okay.
The one stamped copy is, of course, the current, what exists now. And the one that says new on it is increased by 3.2%, minimums and maximums.
3.2?
Uh-huh, because Tom requested it be 3.2 because of the federal COLA.
National.
Okay.
National is what drives the matrix.
Right. Okay.
Right.
And then that gives you the distance when you assign the state level.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Makes sense.
Make a motion, we adopt this resolution.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to adopt the resolution. Call for a vote.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Meeker?
Yes.
Mr. Rainwater?
Yes.
Mr. McDaniel?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Ms. Derry. Any other business? We don't have any, it's on the agenda, so.
I just want to say.
Yes, sir.
Thanks to Tom.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna do.
All his hard work and.
Yes, Tom.
Yep.
I'm sure these quarterly budget meetings are gonna be all that more important this year more than ever.
He's worked hard on it. I believe, and I may be wrong, you can correct me if I'm wrong. I think the department heads did a pretty good job of getting you what you needed when you needed it, Tom, for the most part. And I know there was some additions today. I did one myself. But yeah, thank you to everybody that had anything to do with it, Charlotte, of course, and everybody for getting everything together. And Tom, thank you for your hard work. Thank you. Yeah, absolutely. I will tell you that the nothing gets done around here without people, and we have the best people, and I appreciate you considering that when you look at these merit raises and COLA. So thank you very much.
I like the audiovisual stuff too. That really made it made it nice.
So I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. You are adjourned. Thank you all very much.